The thought was to begin with a couple of minutes of silence. And since this talk will be it's part of the series of sutta talks, it might be a good time to enter a sense of the silence as preparing the mind for the teacher showing up. Teacher not being me, the teacher being speaking through the discourses, the voice of the Buddha, the voice of the other monks and nuns and so on. So one gets a sense, certainly from reading the discourses, that when the Buddha did show up, there was this sense of anticipation. Anticipation not in the sense of we're going to get all entertained and excited, but there's something real going on here, and I'm going to show up. I'm going to listen carefully. I'm going to lend ear. And so with that, I'll ring a bell, and we can all drop in together. So today, in our second sutta talk, we're going to look at the greater discourse in Gosinga, and it's from the Majjhima Nikāya. And in this, I gave it my own subtitle, Eight Visions of a Fine and Excellent Being. But really, I think that you'll come to see that this discourse is resting on visions of a fine and excellent being, but really what we're looking at is the beauty, the nature, the strength of spiritual friendship. So it starts, thus have I heard, of course, the suttas are heard. On one occasion, the Blessed One was living in the park of the Gosinga solitary wood together with a number of very well-known elder disciples, the Venerable Sariputta, the Venerable Mahamoggallana, the Venerable Mahakasapa, the Venerable Anuruddha, the Venerable Revata, the Venerable Ananda, and other very well-known elder disciples. So let me give you a sense of what just happened there. It's as if we're starting out a story and saying, and there was a lovely gathering, and it was with Bishop Tutu, and Mahatma Gandhi was there, Martin Luther King was there. I mean, these people being named, you may not know them as well as our latter-day social activists, but these people were the most well-known elder disciples of the Buddha, not just because they were old. There were plenty of old disciples. These were the giants of the Dhamma at the Buddha's time. Sariputta was the marshal of the Dhamma. He was the most developed as far as wisdom goes, and the one that was always turned to if the Buddha wasn't around, and that the Buddha himself just enjoyed talking to. I mean, this was, you know, this was an extraordinary individual. But you can say that about each of these people, as you'll see in this discourse. So right as you begin this sutta, it's like, wow, okay, this is unusual. This is really something. But then you have this lovely next scene, if you will, when it's like, okay, you can see the beginnings of a party forming in the woods. Then it was in the evening, Mahamoggallana rose from meditation, went to the Venerable Mahakasapa and said to him, "Friend Kasapa, let's go to the Venerable Sariputta to listen to the Dhamma." "Yes, friend," the Venerable Mahakasapa said. Then the Venerable Mahamoggallana, the Venerable Mahakasapa, and the Venerable Anuruddha went to the Venerable Sariputta to listen to the Dhamma. So, you know, Sariputta's hanging out, and, you know, a few of his brother monks come over. But then, when Venerable Ananda saw them going to Sariputta, he went to Venerable Revata and said, "Hey, you know, these guys are going to listen to Sariputta. Why don't we go with them?" And Revata said, "Yeah, let's all go." And then when they, you know, so you have this sense of gathering from different parts of the monastery, different parts of the woods, and it's this beautiful moonlit night. And the Venerable Sariputta saw the Venerable Revata and the Venerable Ananda coming at a distance and said to the Venerable Ananda, "Let the Venerable Ananda come. Welcome to the Venerable Ananda, the Blessed One's attendant." So he immediately goes into this beautiful, respectful speech. "Who is always in the Blessed One's presence, friend Ananda, the Gosinga solitary wood is delightful. The night is moonlit. The solitaries are all in blossom, and heavenly scents seem to be floating in the air. What kind of bhikkhu, friend Ananda, could illuminate the Gosinga solid wood?" So, got these monks gathering, going towards Sariputta. Sariputta says, "Hey, welcome. Nice night, huh?" And you've got this whole setup. The fragrance is really thick. sweet and wonderful. The night is moonlit. These magnificent trees, I'm told that they have the magnificence of the, you know, the California redwoods. You're in this grove. What could possibly illuminate a night like this? Sariputta says to Ananda. And so we launch into the sort of the beginning of the meat of the sutta. But what I want to convey as we enter this is this sense of mutual respect, of happiness, of friendliness of these different monks. And Ananda says, "Here, friend Sariputta, a bhikkhu has learned much, remembers what he has learned, and consolidates what he has learned. Such teachings as are good in the beginning, good in the middle, and good in the end, with the right meaning and the right phrases." And he goes on like that and says, and he teaches the four assemblies, which is lay men, lay women, ordained men, ordained women, with well-rounded and coherent statements and phrases for the eradication of the underlying tendencies. That kind of bhikkhu could illuminate this Gosinga sallow tree wood. So basically, Ananda provides this lovely vision of someone, you know, just really has mastered the Dhamma verbally. And it's a lovely image. And the story goes on. When this was said, the Venerable Sariputta addressed the Venerable Revata thus. Who's, you know, remember they're all gathered there. "Friend Revata, the Venerable Ananda has spoken according to his own inspiration. Now, we ask the Venerable Revata, friend Revata, the Gosinga solitary wood is delightful, the night is moonlit, the solitaries are all in blossom, and heavenly scents seem to be floating in the air. What kind of bhikkhu, friend Revata, would illuminate this Gosinga solitary wood?" So let's talk about this a little bit. So, first thing is, Sariputta addressed Revata and said, okay, Ananda shared his vision, and saying, Ananda has spoken according to his own inspiration. That word inspiration or understanding or illumination, experience-based intelligence, is this Patibhana. And it's one of the really hidden gems of this discourse, just this word Patibhana. So what it means is that what's important about it is that it refers to a vision. In this case, Ananda says this kind of monk would light up the, you know, the solitary wood. And he's arrived at that from his own experience. So he's claiming, not with any arrogance, he just knows this is a beautiful, this kind of person is beautiful, a person who can speak the Dhamma with such eloquence and is willing to share it and shares it with clarity with all who come. And he arrived at that, Ananda arrived at that directly through experience. It wasn't a something that the Buddha taught him. So this Patibhana gives one a sense of this inner arrived vision, this clarity, this certainty. And from that, Ananda says, this is who would light up the wood. So what we're being invited into as listeners to this discourse is that direction, that apprehension that Ananda himself had directly and personally. So the next one is from Revata. And so we're setting the pattern, because as you'll see, Revata also speaks, as Sariputta later says, from his own inspiration, from direct experience, in other words, from his own wisdom. And Revata says, "Here, friend Sariputta, a bhikkhu delights in solitary meditation and takes delight in solitary meditation. He is devoted to internal serenity of mind and does not neglect meditation, possesses insight, and dwells in empty huts. That kind of bhikkhu could illuminate the Gosinga solitary wood." So here's a different vision. This guy, this is not someone who speaks beautifully of the Dhamma. This is Revata's vision, and it's of a solitary meditator. Doesn't neglect meditation. Is devoted to internal serenity of mind. And so we're invited into Revata's personally arrived at vision, direct understanding of the excellent being, the excellent person, that which would illuminate the woods. And so we go on. The next is Anuruddha. When this was said, the Venerable Sariputta addressed a Venerable Anuruddha. "Here, friend Sariputta," this is now Anuruddha speaking, "what would light up the woods? With the divine eye, which is purified and surpasses the human, the bhikkhu surveys 1,000 worlds, just as a man with good sight, when he has ascended to the upper palace chamber, might survey 1,000 wheel rims. So too, with the divine eye, which is purified and surpasses the human, a bhikkhu surveys 1,000 worlds. That kind of bhikkhu could illuminate the Gosinga Sala tree wood." So once again, arrived at himself, we have Venerable Anuruddha, who was known for his superpowers, basically. This was the main superpower monk. And he says, yeah, well, God, yeah, someone with superpowers, that would do it, sure. And he's arrived at that because he knows it, right? He knows it in his own heart. So we're being invited to say, oh, well, here's another vision. You got the verbal mastery. You got the not neglecting meditation. You got the divine eye. Well, let's see, what else does this, what else do we have here? And now we go over to Mahakasapa. And Mahakasapa is not messing around. And he's basically telling us that a forest dweller himself, and speaks in praise of forest dwelling. He's an alms food eater and speaks in praise of eating alms food. He's a refuse rag wearer himself and speaks in praise of wearing refuse rag robes. He is a triple robe wearer and speaks in praise of that. He has few wishes and speaks in praise of that. Content, speaks in praise of contentment. Secluded, speaks in praise of seclusion. And going on, he's attained to deliverance himself and speaks in praise of the attainment of deliverance. So now we have Mahakasapa, a different vision. Remember that this is all Patibhana. Sariputta then will say, after each of these, you know, Mahakasapa has spoken according to his own Patibhana, his own inspiration, his own direct experience. And so we're seeing how Mahakasapa arrived at this understanding directly and from the heart, and respectfully sharing it with his, you know, his brothers. Then we go to Mahamoggallana, and this is another one of the gems. So when this was said, Venerable Sariputta addressed the Venerable Mahamoggallana. And so what kind of, you know, monk would light up this wood? "Here, friend Sariputta, 2 bhikkhus engage in a talk on the higher Dhamma, and they question each other, and each being questioned by the other answers without foundering, and tell me if this is familiar to you. And their talk rolls on in accordance with the Dhamma. That kind of bhikkhu could illuminate this Gosinga solitary wood. Their talk rolls on in accordance with the Dhamma. The two bhikkhus, not one, but what is inspiring Mahamoggallana is these bhikkhus in relationship, sharing the Dhamma in a quality of conversation that just rolls on in accordance with the Dhamma. So wait a minute. That's lighting up the Gosinga solitary wood, not just the solitary meditator or the guy wearing the rag robes. This too is a patibana, an inspiration. And so let's talk a little bit about, before we go on to the other visions, let's talk a little bit about where Mahamoggallana is coming from, why he says this thing that's so different. Everyone else is just answering this kind of monk, this kind of monk, this kind of monk. Now this guy's saying, these two monks engaged in this conversation, but the Dhamma just rolls on in accordance with itself, you know? So remember I told you that Sariputta was known as the, you might say, commander-in-chief, you know, the marshal of the Dhamma is the word often used. And when monks were first ordained, they often went through the Sariputta mill. You know, they had to really learn the stuff that Sariputta had to teach them. And Sariputta was, I don't know that he had a reputation as a tough teacher. I don't know one way or another. But it was definitely one got the sense of this guy was the first, shall we say, opportunity or challenge to immerse yourself in the rules, in the nature of the Dhamma, why are we gathered, all this stuff. And it was very, very clear with him. He was known for, as I said, his wisdom. Well, the other most senior, most respected disciple of the Buddha was Mahamoggallana. So these two guys were considered the two chief disciples, Mahamoggallana and Venerable Sariputta. And they, interestingly enough, had been friends since childhood. Grew up in the same town, and they were very, very close, inseparable, and came to their wisdom in Mahamoggallana's case a little bit later than Sariputta, and where Sariputta went on to be this chief disciple in wisdom, Mahamoggallana was chief disciple by virtue of how he cared for and nurtured others. And someone needs to be muted, I'm not sure. So let me tell you, just as Sariputta had a nickname, the Marshal of the Dhamma, Mahamoggallana had one as well, and it was the nursemaid of the Dhamma. Which is to say, all of the people who, you know, after they went through the initial threshold of Sariputta, it was Mahamoggallana who would nurture them going forward, according to their needs. So it was a much more specialized, attentive quality of relationship. So what Mahamoggallana is talking about here and saying, here, friend, two bhikkhus engage in a talk on the higher Dhamma, and they question each other. And in being questioned by the other answers without foundering, and their talk rolls on in accordance with the Dhamma, that kind of bhikkhu, or we should say those kinds of bhikkhus, could illuminate this Gosinga Sala tree wood. So Mahamoggallana's whole way of being and serving the larger community was through relationship, through a nurturing relationship as the monks matured. And in some sense, one gets this feeling of that relational quality was necessary for that maturation. In other words, you can't just lay out a bunch of rules, lay out a bunch of Dhamma, and say, okay, go mature, go ripen. That's what Sariputta, how Sariputta got them started. But Mahamoggallana actually took them when they were already a little bit ripened through Sariputta, and in this relational way, engaged with them as they needed. And he saw the beauty of that. And in responding to the question, what would light up this, you know, this beautiful wood on this gorgeous night, that's his answer. Two bhikkhus engage in a talk on the higher Dhamma. So that's according to his vision. And then Mahamoggallana was the last one. So now, when this was said, Mahamoggallana, who we just heard from, addressed Venerable Sariputta and said, you know, basically, we've all shared what we, you know, our vision of what would light up this this beautiful grove. And respectfully, knowing that it wouldn't be seemly for Sariputta to just say what he thinks, Mahamoggallana asks his brother monk, you know, friend Sariputta, we have spoken according to our own inspiration. Now we ask the Venerable Sariputta. Friend Sariputta, the Gosinga Sala tree wood is delightful. The night is moonlit. The Sala trees are all in blossom, and heavenly scents seem to be floating in the air. What kind of bhikkhu, friend Sariputta, could illuminate this Gosinga Sala tree wood? And as you might expect from the master of wisdom, Sariputta answers, here, friend Moggallana, a bhikkhu wields mastery over his mind. He does not let the mind wield mastery over him. In the morning, he abides in whatever abiding or attainment he wants to abide in during the morning. And at midday, he abides in whatever abiding or attainment he wants to abide in at midday, and in the evening, likewise. And then there's this analogy that you see, or simile that you see elsewhere in the discourses. Suppose a king or king's minister had a chest full of variously colored garments. In the morning, he could put on whatever pair of garments he wanted to put on in the morning. Midday, he could put on whatever he wants midday. Later, put on whatever he wants to put on later. And so too, a bhikkhu wields mastery over his mind. He does not let the mind wield mastery over him. So if you get this sense of any mind state to which, any meditative state to which Sariputta might wish to attain, he just takes it on, like putting on another pair of clothing. That's some serious mastery, right? Anytime. Just whatever. So that's his inspiration. Wow. There's all of these incredible, inspiring visions, each and every one of them arrived at through direct experience, right? Each and every one of them is patibhana, arrived at this with this quality of immediately experienced wisdom. So what do you think is going to happen next? Well, naturally, the masterful turn to the master. So the Sariputta addressed the venerable ones and said, we've all spoken according to our inspiration. Let's go to the Blessed One and report this matter to him. As the Blessed One answers, so let us remember it. Yes, friend, they replied. Then those venerable ones went to the Blessed One, and after paying homage to him, they sat down at one side. So, what do you think we're going to get? Well, the first thing you almost always get when a conversation has happened outside the presence of the Buddha is that that conversation is recounted in front of the Buddha. For one thing, it provides a canonical technique for validating those teachings, you know, according to this one particular master called Gautama Buddha, right? So it's a way of providing a provenance, you might say, for the teaching. So they do that. And the Buddha, the Sariputta recounts to the Buddha exactly what had happened. And then after Sariputta says what it was that Ananda said, the Buddha says, good, good, Sariputta. Ananda, speaking rightly, should speak just as he did. For Ananda has learned much, remembers what he has learned, and consolidates what he has learned. So the Buddha is validating Ananda's vision of this illuminating monk as being one with the verbal mastery. And then he goes on and Sariputta reports what Revata has said. Now Revata, by the way, Revata is Sariputta's little brother. So, you know, as part of the scene that we're looking at here, they're gathered around the master, they're reporting what they've experienced, and you've got Sariputta is lifelong friends with Mahamoggallana, and you've got his little brother, Revata's there. Revata, by the way, was the name I was given as a monk. And so, you have this continued sense of very familial, very friendly. And so after Sariputta says what his little brother had said, the Buddha says, good, good, Sariputta, Revata, speaking rightly, should speak just as he did when he said that basically the meditating monk would light up the woods. And then, good, good, Sariputta, Aniruddha, speaking rightly, should speak just as he did, which is, you know, the divine eye. And good, good, Sariputta, Kassapa, speaking rightly, should speak just as he did, you know, the rag robes wearer, the alms food eater. And good, good, Sariputta, Moggallana, speaking rightly, should speak just as he did. For Moggallana is one who talks on the Dhamma. He's the, you know, the one who spoke of the, basically the dialogue. And then the Mahamoggallana told the Blessed One, then Venerable Sir, I address Sariputta. And Sariputta answered, what kind of monk would light up these woods? And then Moggallana, a bhikkhu wields mastery over the mind. And the Buddha replied, good, good, Mahamoggallana. Sariputta, speaking rightly, should speak just as he did. Okay. So now what would happen? What would be the next thing that would happen? They've all spoken. Who would light up the woods? What kind of monk would do that? Who hasn't spoken? The Buddha, right? So, naturally, when this was said, the Venerable Sariputta asked the Blessed One, Venerable Sir, which of us have spoken well? And the Buddha said, you've all spoken well, Sariputta, each in his own way. Hear also from me what kind of bhikkhu could illuminate this Gosinga solitary wood. Hear, Sariputta, when a bhikkhu has returned from his alms round, after his meal, he sits down, folds his legs crosswise, sets his body erect, and establishing mindfulness in front of him, resolves, I shall not break this sitting position until, through not clinging, my mind is liberated from the taints, from the intoxicants, the asava. That kind of bhikkhu could illuminate this Gosinga solitary wood. That's a pretty different vision, isn't it? Here you've got these highly accomplished monks, the most senior disciples of the Buddha, each naming basically a monk that looks exactly like them as one who would illuminate the woods, right? Revata names a Revata, and Kaspa names a Kasapa, and Mahamoggallana has got these guys in dialogue because that's what he does. And then when it's time for the Buddha, he says, no, just ordinary monk sitting down, crossing legs, and so committed to practice. You know, I shall not break this sitting position until through non-clinging my mind is liberated. Very humble, intense, but humble. So, that is what the Blessed One said. Those Venerable Ones were satisfied and delighted in the Blessed One's words. They were delighted. So here you have it. These visions, these patibhana. And I wonder, you know, what are your visions? What is it that guides you? What sense of possibility? What sense, what is in your own heart, in your own mind? What is the quality of attainment that would illuminate the woods? Do you have one? And where does that image come from? Out of what was it forged? Visions from perhaps a teacher that inspired you, something that you read in some book somewhere, or in the discourses or something. These visions, you know, they're part of our mind, whether we are intentional about it or not. We guide ourselves according to these things. So I'd like to open up the space and ask you, if you're willing to, generously, share, what are the higher values? What is it in the monk or the nun, the male or the female lay person, that is beautiful, inspiring? Through what you've touched in your own practice, in your own heart, patibhana, your own inspiration, what is beautiful? What is illuminating? So I'll ring a bell, and out of that fading of the bell, perhaps someone will have the generosity to share.
So this is a good question. One I don't think about very much. And what comes up for me is a vision of selflessness, so that there's availability to be of service, not necessarily in this big, huge, giant way of saving all beings from suffering, but just where the self can dissolve a bit to be really present and to speak the truth. So just going back to this this sutta, I was actually a little bit disappointed in the Buddha, because I wanted the Buddha to say something about it's this relationship or it's this sangha. It was kind of all building up for me that the last person who was going to speak wasn't really a person at all, but it was the community of wisdom. So I was a little disappointed in what the Buddha said. But I also feel that this practice, that this vision of selflessness is something that is not, it can only be cultivated in relationship. Because in a way, relationship is the hardest place. It's where all the selfing, not all the selfing, but a lot of it comes up most poignantly. In relationship.
I agree with them all, and I was thinking of the notion of right form, right function, and I'm particularly in touch with the Insight Dialogue Guideline Trust Emergence, and I was thinking how what would illuminate would is so changing, really. And my partner Jane and I have just come back from running a Insight Dialogue Day, and last night we were fine-tuning what we'd planned, and we were inspired by the last time we met with you, Greg, when you were doing all this work on pause. So we decided, let's just stay with pause. It was pause, entering into the new year with kindness. And then we had to make something out of that. And we decided to stay with pause, but just very gently touch on each of the other guidelines. and focus on every day, so that the practice day would be really illuminating around the everyday things, like going for a walk, having lunch, making tea for a friend, reading something to a dyad partner. But we planned it so well, and then we got to the last bit, and we just couldn't do it, and we kept trying, and it just didn't come. So how to bring it all back together? So in the end, we said, well, we'll just go to sleep and hope something comes. And then, so I had this notepad by my bed. We were sleeping in separate rooms, and I closed my eyes, and I went back into a old practice that I did many years ago, which is just following the internal light. And it was very luminous, and I don't always see in such a luminous way. And it was rather lovely, but it didn't bring anything together for me. And then I fell asleep, and then at four I woke up and to go to the toilet, and I was completely inspired, and I just saw how to pull it all together. And I sat and wrote something down, and then of course we executed the day, and it was a joy to just sit with 11 people and practice. And there was a lot of sharing the facilitation. Sometimes I was just practicing, and sometimes I was facilitating. And it was just trusting the evolution of the day. Although we'd planned things, we were also quite creative, and seeing how it landed in other people. And then they were generously so alive in the practice, it was inspiring. And I'm so in touch, and then coming here and being able to practice with you guys and meet with you. And I didn't have time to read the sutta, but it's so lovely to be reminded about sitting with friends. So I just think of that flow of being in practice and entering into what's appropriate from moment to moment. Thank you.
There were two things that were emerging. In addition to reading the Buddha's, what felt like just this commitment, like, we'll sit until this, like this deep intention and commitment to liberation, not just to a mind state or all the other things that people name, which are lovely and amazing, you know, that the other monks name, but this like cutting through directly to like true liberation. And Greg, I so appreciate this question, because it feels like it redirects me back. Maybe what for me are these two core elements. One is love to a heart that is capable of being with and tolerating its own reactivity for the sake of showing up in a loving way. Not in a fixed view, loving means nice or anything like that, but I know the difference between when I'm coming from a place of love, which we were just practicing with in the cohort this week, and when I'm not, when I can't be with my own reactivity enough to reorient to love. And the other is this just profound spaciousness and insubstantiality like when mind is just wide open and free and awake. Oops. And that sense of like the true nature of things is such an inspiration, you know? So it feels like these two dimensions, you know? Like it's not just the bright, awake, spacious mind phenomena. It's also this like heart of love and a heart of love to work with the reactivity enough to show up in a different way that is beneficial or kind in this world. Yeah, thank you.
I'm feeling very inspired by the Buddha's, you know, initial response of affirming each person's vision. And how that affirming of the vision of each person supports the non-clinging that was part of his vision. And for me, that also, you know, you asked where does the vision come from in our own mind, our own hearts. And I mean, I feel like that generosity and that non-clinging that the Buddha demonstrates, there are many sources for that in the Buddha's teachings, but I actually have this memory, Greg, from the first retreat, ID retreat that I sat with you. There was a person at the retreat who I was finding very annoying. And I remember that he, you know, said something in our large group. And I just have this vision, this memory of you responding to him with such generosity. You said, "What I like about what you're saying is blah, 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 blah." You know, you found this something about what he said that you could point to as wholesome. And I've just always carried that with me. Because for me, it's so inspiring to know that that's possible. And I feel like the ID practice helps, you know, supports that, supports being able to be present enough and generous enough to let go of views and to be with the wholesome that's present in the moment. Thank you.
This is Michael. My name isn't on the screen, but this is Michael. And what I liked about the Sutta is that it brought me to an imagination that I'm in the grove with Sariputta asking me that question and looking for that answer in myself. And finding an answer that I would say to him, that it's the bhikkhu or myself that practices the Dharma well enough to inspire others to ask how to practice. And follow. That's all. Thank you.
At first, this is Mariah, and listening to your questions, I was trying to sort out exactly what you were asking of us, and found myself looking at my own intentions and motives. You know, what is it that drives me to practice? But then as I've sat here and listened to the Sangha that's gathered here share their inspiration, it was really clear to me that, and I can almost cry when I say this, that it is the bhikkhus gathered together with the wise teacher that provides the inspiration for me and the sincere inquiry that occurs in inside dialogue with the wise teachings as the contemplation, and then each heart responding in the moment from where what they're experiencing. So it's that sincere investigation with the support of wisdom that keeps me going and keeps me wanting to grow and work through my own obscurations and clingings and desires that you wonder, why am I still doing this? But it's the Sangha that is bringing about growth. So thank you.
Something about each of these senior disciples, highly respected, each one had attained to a high level of insight and understanding. Each made major contributions to the Sangha as a whole. They were active participants in the community. None of them were, as a result of their engagement with the community, none of them neglected their individual practice either. It was all of a piece. And in some sense, how beautiful is it that in this gathering of dedicated, mature people, one has a sense of the practices and the understandings offered by the Buddha, having landed and done this work, that such a community has blossomed, that such a beautiful night can occur with spontaneously, these exquisite beings gathering and and that there can be this sense of variety, none of it wrong, none of it, you know, considered to be inferior. I mean, even though the Buddha spoke later, you couldn't say that that's the correct answer. You know, they're all correct answers. And everybody's arriving at these answers through direct experience as a result of insight in the Dhamma, of following the teachings, following the practices, functioning together as a community to support this possibility of this path. So the vision of community to me that's offered here is also very beautiful. It's true that it's all male, and you know, the time in history in which this unfolded, that would have been certainly the norm. And what was outside the norm was that there was in fact a bhikkhunis community as well, and that it would have been as kind of mature and well-respected as it was. But given that it's all male, and, you know, just sort of letting that be digested, hopefully it can be acceptable to those who are not male. That it also represents a quality of relationship among this inner group of such sweet friendship, the respectfulness with which they speak to each other and listen to each other, the delight at which they gather. Hey, yeah, Sariputta's hanging out. Let's go. And, you know, someone sees him going, oh, they're going to listen to Sariputta. Let's go too. And it's like, it really did convey this sense of a Dhamma party, you know, and spontaneous and run through with a quality of delight that is not a kind of a titillating, debased delight, but a delight of the a kind that you can trust, you know, kind of delight you can trust. You can just say, yeah, that feels good. That's I like that. So part of what I take away is these images of relationship and community. Regardless of what the individual messages were as to who illuminates the grove.
Well, I know that I feel this just looking at the screen with so many memories of that kind of delight in cohort or out of cohort, and even just gazing upon these faces and knowing our intention, our shared intention, a kind of very special delight arises. So I don't think we're that far from, I don't know that we're any distance from that, the Buddha Sangha of his time.
Very nice.
Noble friends coming together.
Right. So if there's no other offerings now, I thought I might bring us
to... Can you just shut this door for me?
What's that? So is that okay to bring to a close? Okay, so maybe that's a good place to leave us, is this practice of the gratitude flowing out of a community rooted in metta and loving kindness. A wish for all these beings here at this meeting to be happy and free, to be a bright and beautiful glowing core out of which emerges further love and compassion for all the beings who aren't here, within the community, beyond the community. Every human being, every animal being, every bird and reptile and fish, insect, being seen and unseen, that they all may be included in this bright, open mind of compassion. May all beings who are suffering be free from suffering. May all beings without exception benefit from our practice together, from our investigation. May all beings without exception be at peace. May there be peace. May there be peace. May there be peace. Thank you very much, friends.